So let's talk a little bit about variables in C. So variables are declared by type and name, just like they are in Java. They can be initialized when they're declared, which is recommended. It is not recommended to use to declare a variable without initializing it first, because in C you're not going to get an initialized value. It's not going to be a default value. It's just going to be whatever value was in memory that was allocated for that variable. And so it's highly recommended that you always initialize a variable when you declare it. You can declare variables to be const, which is very similar to final in Java. So it has to be initialized, and then the value cannot change. Multiple declarations per line are allowed, although I don't recommend this because it can lead to some misleading syntax. For example, in this declaration here, it appears as though we're declaring two variables, x and y, that are both equal to 1, but that's not actually what's going on here. What's happening is that we're declaring x to be undefined or uninitialized, and y is going to be set the initial value of 1. And so I recommend that you only declare one variable per line, essentially. There are a bunch of data types that are built into C. There are integer types like char and int. These can be signed or unsigned, and we'll talk more in a couple of weeks about the differences between those two. There are also some modifiers that you can use, so you can have a short int or a long int or a long int, and that refers to the amount of space on disk that is reserved for that integer. There are also some real types that use a floating point representation. These are float and double, which are named the same as they are in Java, and we'll spend some time talking about those a little bit later in the course as well. So here's kind of a summary of the different data types and their sizes on STU. So this, if you ask for an int on our student server at JMU, you're going to get something that is 4 bytes long. And if you ask for something that is a double, you'll get a floating point number that is 8 bytes long. But those are just the numbers on STU. It turns out that the C standard itself doesn't actually mandate integer widths. It only specifies a minimum, which can actually cause problems when there are a bunch of different architectures, if you're writing for different kinds of computers, and the computers themselves, the hardware architecture, actually provides different actual sizes. And so in some places in this course, we're actually going to use a more portable alternative, which are integer types that are defined in this header file called standard integer, or stdint. And the basic format here is that the type name is going to be some number x, some letter x, and then int, and then some number y, and then an underscore t. And so there are a bunch of different types that all correspond to the same basic pattern. The x can either be empty, or it can be u for unsigned, and then y can be one of the following, so 8, 16, 32, or 64, and this is a count of the number of bits. So for instance, an int 8t is a signed value because the x part is empty, and then each number is 8 bits wide, which is what the 8 means. A uint 8t would then be an unsigned 8-bit integer. An int 32t would be a signed 32-bit integer, and a uint 64t would be an unsigned 64-bit integer. So there are 6 main attributes to every variable. This is something that you'll study in more depth when you take CS430. But for now, I just want to give you sort of a brief working definition of these things so that we can use them to talk about these attributes in the context of C. So every variable has a name, it has a value, it has a type. It also has an address, a scope, and a lifetime. So the name, value, and type you're familiar with from the intro courses. So the name is just an identifier that you use to refer to the variable in code. The value of a variable is, of course, the current contents of that variable. And the type is the range of values a variable can store. So for instance, if a variable is an integer, then that is its type, and that encodes that it can store, you know, all possible integers that are representable using the given width of that integer. So we're going to define a couple of other attributes here. So the address of a variable is the location of that variable's value. So where is it actually stored in memory? And here's where we're going to start to look at variables at a slightly lower level than we maybe did in a language like Java. So there are a couple different locations where a variable could be stored. The most common ones are in a register, on the stack, on the heap, or in static data. And we'll talk more about these regions here in a little bit. And we're going to focus on the non-register locations for now. We'll come back and talk about registers later in the course. So the address is the place where the variable is being stored. The scope of a variable is the code range where a variable is visible. So where can you get access to that visible or to that variable in your code? So a global variable is visible anywhere in a file. Whereas a local variable, a variable that is local to a function, is only going to be visible inside of that function. And sometimes if you declare a variable inside of a block, it's only visible inside of that block, which is even smaller scope than function level scope. Scope is closely related, but not directly associated with lifetime. There's sort of a loose coupling between these concepts. So the lifetime of a variable is the time period during execution when it's valid to access that variable. And so we generally distinguish between two types of lifetime. So there is a static lifetime where the variable is allocated when the program starts, and then it is deallocated when the program exits. So basically the variable is there in memory for the entire execution of the program. This is in contrast to a dynamic variable, which is allocated and deallocated while the program runs. So at some point while the program is running, the variable is allocated in memory, and then at some point later on while the program is running, the variable becomes deallocated. And this could be done explicitly or implicitly. So the programmer might have to do this themselves, or the language and the runtime system might handle it for them.